Hey everyone, today I'm going to be giving an introduction to Unity's shader graph. This is going to be the foundation for many of my future tutorials. I'm game dev Bill, let's get started. Today I will talk a little bit about how vertex shaders play into shader graph, but for the most part I'm going to focus on the fragment shader. As a sample, I'm going to make a shader effect that will take your image, make it black and white, color tint it blue, and then take everything that was yellow in the original image and make it remain its original yellow. So to start off, I'm going to create a shader effect for this sprite here in this scene. We'll right click, go to create, shader, and then the main two you're ever going to use are unlit graph or PBR graph. Basically, unlit is unlit and PBR is lit. So for this sprite, I can choose unlit because that's all I need to work with today. Jumping into the shader graph, there's a few things to look at. There's a blackboard, a master node, and a main preview. I always turn off main preview. I don't really ever use it. Blackboard, you need to have on when you're adding and removing inputs, but other than that, I like to have it off. To start, I'm going to add a texture 2D. I'm going to call it something. This name doesn't actually matter. This is what the name is in the graph. The important thing, though, is the reference. This has to be called underscore main text if you're going to use this as an effect fed by Unity, as a sprite render or a full screen render or something like that. It has to be underscore main text. It's really important. To use it, simply drag it into the shader graph. Then we can close the blackboard, get started. I'm going to drag a wire out of this input. And when I let go, it gives me the option to choose what node it's going to feed into. I'm going to type sample because I want to feed it into a texture sampler. It automatically is set up to take the UVs in. So I can just wire the output into the color node of my unlit master. Now, note, you have to hit the save asset button. If you go to file, save, or anything like that, it doesn't actually save the shader. Now to set this up with a material, you can right click on the shader and go to create material, and it'll automatically create a material using this shader. Now I'll just drag this material onto my sprite and my sprite disappears. This isn't actually related to shader graph, but I wanted to show it to you because I run into it from time to time. Unity's default sprite rendering material is two-sided, but when you set up a shader graph, by default it's not. So I dragged it onto a sprite that I was actually looking at the back of and didn't realize it. So if I turn things around and get it lined up correctly, my sprite reappears. Jumping back into the shader graph, I'm going to briefly talk about how vertex shaders are set up. Now, the key here is that in a shader graph, you're setting up the vertex and fragment program together. There's one master node that takes both vertex input and fragment input. For the most part, this won't really affect you and won't really be an issue, but the main gotcha I want to mention is that Unity is going to compile this shader graph into two separate functions, the vertex function and the fragment function, and you cannot pass data between them in shader graph. As an example, I'm going to take my normal vector, which is an input to the shader, feed it into a preview node, and then feed it into the master node. And then I'm going to copy the normal vector in preview and feed it in again. One of those I'm going to feed into the vertex normals, which is a vertex function output, and one of those I'm going to feed into the color, which is the fragment shader output. This works fine when there's copies. As soon as I try to get rid of one of those connections and wire up the same normal vector to both previews, Unity won't let me. And you'll probably run into this in surprising ways where you're trying to wire two nodes together and Unity just refuses to let them get connected. Pretty much every time, this is the issue. Unity thinks some of those nodes belong in the vertex program and some of those nodes belong in the fragment program, and it won't let you wire them together. With that introduction, I'm now going to focus on fragment shaders. The main nodes I want to talk about first are split and combine. If you're used to shader code, you can just write some variable .x or .y to access one of its channels. In shader graph, you can't do that except on the texture 2D sampler node. That's the only node where the outputs are pre-split up for you. Everything else, say I take this UV node, I'm going to have to feed that into a split to have access to its parameters. Now in a UV, you're thinking x and y. But when you feed it into a split, it's still going to be called RGBA. So you just have to get in your head that R is X and G is Y and so on. With the basis covered here, now I'm going to get into my actual example. I'm going to take my sampler node and feed that into a dot product. Now, normally dot product is used for vector math to do geometry type things. In this case, I'm using it for colors because the dot product, if you don't remember, will take two vectors, multiply them channel by channel, and then add up the result, which is exactly what I want to do to convert this to black and white. So I'm going to set these inputs to 0.3, 0.59, and 0.11, which is a good way to get black and white because the way the human eye perceives color isn't actually even by RGB. Now you'll notice that the preview image is white. That's because this shader doesn't have any idea what texture is going to be driven into it. So I can save it and I can go back to my main scene and see what this looks like to validate that it is going to be black and white. But wouldn't it be nice if I didn't have to keep going back to the main scene? Well, luckily there is a way in the blackboard for the input main text, I can actually choose a default texture. And the default doesn't matter when I'm actually using this in game. I can override it. Anytime you put this material on a sprite, it's going to set the texture for me. This is really just so that I can preview things in Shader Graph. Next, we want to color tint it. So I'm going to take the output of this black and white node and feed it into a multiply. Then to drive that multiply, I'm going to put a color node. Now you'll notice, originally, this multiply was a 1x1 multiply, but since I'm driving one of the inputs by a color, which is a 4-channel thing, the shader graph automatically cleans that up and makes everything 4 channels, and it just all works out. So I can go in here and pick a color that I want to use here, some green or whatever, but I actually want this to be driven by the material. So if I right-click on the node, I can convert to property. Going over to the blackboard, you can see that it showed up here. It's got a name called color. I'm going to rename it to tint. And I don't actually care about the reference. It's just going to be some garbage string, but I'm not driving this from code, so I don't need to set it. If I wanted to set this from code, then I would put that to something like probably underscore tint. Now if I go look at my material, you'll see I can pick the color from the material and it'll override what the shader had built in. So we've got the tinting working, and now I said I was going to make it so that everything that was originally yellow will stay yellow and not be black and whited or tinted. To do that, I need to have branching logic. I need to have something that's conditional on what the source color was. Now in code shaders, you can write if and have an if check in there. It's not very efficient and not recommended for code shaders. In Shader Graph, that's just really not even an option. So the two things that are going to become your friend are step and smooth step. Those nodes will help you do this sort of math. And essentially what you need to do is you calculate what the color is going to be in both instances, and then use step and a multiply to figure out which one to actually output. So let me walk this through. To find yellow, I'm going to add R and G together and then subtract B. And if I feed that into a step node, you can see all the yellow parts are 1, a full brightness, and everything that wasn't yellow in the scene is darker. So if I multiply my original source color by this step node, then now I get only the yellow parts as their original yellow. I can then feed this step output into a 1 minus to invert it, and multiply that by the tinted version of the scene. And then when I add those two together, I get a final product that's either tinted or yellow, depending on what the source color was. Now this is a small and simple graph, but it's already gotten messy. There's already a lot of crossing wires and chaos here, so I need to clean that up. I highly recommend you frequently clean up your graphs or things will get out of hand really quick. As it stands, this shader will do what I talked about in the introduction of black and white, color tint, and then saving the yellow things. But there's one more thing I want to do, which is I want to flicker the yellow things. The reason I want to do this is because it highlights the time node. Using a time node is one of the fundamental ways to make your shader alive. So what we're going to do here is I'm going to take time, multiply it by some value, and feed it into simple noise. This gives me a nice flickering. I'm going to take that simple noise, feed it into multiply to scale it, and then I can multiply it by my color. Now in this case, my noise is less than 1, so it's only going to be darkening, but I actually want it to only brighten. So I'm going to take an add node and add 1. An interesting thing I'll point out is that time is actively running in your shader, but shaders are only redrawn in the scene view when they need to be. So if you're moving the scene around, if you're moving an object, you'll see this flame start to flicker, but when I'm not doing anything, it doesn't. So anytime you have a live shader, the best way to view it is always in play mode. Now that I'm in play mode, I see that I actually want my effect to be a little bit more intense. Luckily, you can edit a shader graph while play mode is going. You'll be able to see the updates right away and everything's still saved when you exit play mode. Yes, this looks much better. Obviously, there's a lot more I could cover, but I wanted to focus on the high level. Keep things simple. This is the baseline for my shader series. Be sure to check that out. Also, I'd really appreciate a subscribe. Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate all of you.